Good morning. Welcome to Sky News Breakfast. Thank you for joining us. Free rapid testing will be made available to families with children in school or college under plans for schools to reopen in England next week. Secondary and college pupils will have lateral flow tests twice weekly. The kits will be available to collect from more than 500 locations across the country. Anisha Sethi reports.
We've all heard the tales and tantrums of homeschooling, but parents will soon be faced with a new role. The government's advising all households with school-aged children to carry out rapid COVID tests twice a week. Parents Jasjot and Mandeep welcome the move.
I don't have an issue with it in terms of how often they have to do the testing, because I think it's not a big ask. If you compare it to the number of people's lives that have been affected, the number of people that have lost their lives, to ask people to do a simple test is not a big deal.
Rapid testing at home means positive cases can isolate quickly. This could be the difference between a class being sent home because of an outbreak or children being able to stay in school.
From the 8th of March, free rapid test kits will be available to collect from over 500 locations. NHS England stresses the effort to detect asymptomatic cases.
Well, I'm sure there will be a lot of assistance for schools and children to do tests. Testing has expanded greatly over the last few months, and it's one important component of our battle against coronavirus.
And it's a battle which school leaders have been fighting for almost a year.
Anything that encourages a joint effort in securing the health, the public health of all of our children going into schools and for teachers, I think, yeah, absolutely, it will encourage teachers to feel far safer coming into school.
As homeschooling soon comes to an end, parents will be swapping marker board pens for lateral flow tests in the next stage of community testing. Anisha Sethi, Sky News.
Let's take a look at the latest coronavirus figures now for the UK. And 7,434 new confirmed cases of COVID-19 were recorded in the most recent 24-hour period. That's the lowest number for around 5 months. A further 290 people have died within 28 days of testing positive. That brings the UK total to 122,705. And 19.6 million first doses of the vaccine have been administered. A £5 billion scheme to help pubs, restaurants and retailers hit hardest by the lockdown is set to be revealed by the Chancellor in Wednesday's budget. Non-essential shops in England and hospitality venues will be able to apply for so-called restart grants. Our political correspondent Rob Powell joins us now from Westminster. And Robert, just how will this much-needed help for the high street actually work?
So the grants will be up to £18,000 per firm, Gillian. They'll be available to shops, restaurants, pubs, but also gyms, hair salons, delivered through local authorities in England, although there'll be extra money going to the devolved nations as well. Now, I think that will be welcomed by business. I expect what they will want to hear from the Chancellor, Rishi Sunak, who you can see there on Wednesday, though, is news about things like the furlough scheme that's been supporting jobs for the past 9-10 months or so, and also business rates too. I think those will be the giveaways, but there's also likely to be the clearest indication yet of how the Chancellor plans to plug the giant hole in the nation's finances caused by the coronavirus bailout, really. We may not get immediate huge tax rises, but there may well be a roadmap and an indication of where they will come further down the track. We've heard all about corporation tax the last few days, taxes on businesses going up. As well, the Sunday Times eye-catchingly reporting today plans to potentially freeze the amount of money that you earn before you start paying tax on income tax. So that will affect far more people. I think, though, a lot of these expected pre-budget leaks, if you like, should be treated with a degree of caution. Right the way through the pandemic, the Treasury has been pretty adept at managing their message and occasionally managing to make their actual policy announcements feel more generous or less stringent than they might do otherwise. And I think the Chancellor will be acutely aware that as much as there is an economic problem to fix on Wednesday, he also needs to look after the politics and his political image, because a lot of backbenchers who look very favourably on Rishi Sunak, they want to see him come out of this as the low tax Chancellor. The challenge is how do you maintain your image as a low tax Chancellor while also putting up taxes?
President Trump will make his first public appearance since leaving the White House later today when he speaks at a conference for American conservatives. Although he remains banned by social media, the former US leader still dominates Republican politics. Organisers say, they believe Mr. Trump has scores to settle this evening. Mr. Bunkle has this report from Orlando in Florida.
There is a conference centre in downtown Orlando this weekend where Donald Trump still rules America. He might have lost the election, but not the faith of his party.
So all my friends still want Trump things. And actually, the hat that I need, I got the one that says 2020 on it, but I need the one that says 2024 on it. We're ready for President Trump to come back. We want to see our president. And I say our president, meaning the people's president.
Trump, the Florida local, will speak here on Sunday, his first public appearance since leaving the White House. Banned from Twitter still, he's bound to have a lot to say.
I think he wants to say the things that will make Twitter the most anxious with him. Which is maybe settling some scores and taking people on who have said some rather unkind things to him. But by the same token, I think he's going to talk about this coalition that he built. I mean, it's a coalition unlike the Republican Party's ever seen before.
You would like Donald Trump to run again in 24, would you?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. I think pretty much everybody here does.
Do you think he will?
I'm hoping so. I think what he's going to do, though, is I don't think he'll commit tomorrow. If you've read his book, The Art of the Deal, he likes to keep options open.
Typically, political parties reinvent themselves after an election loss, not the Republicans. If anything, nothing has changed. They believe in Trump and want more of the same.
No doubt who the star attraction is here, and there's no doubt who they want to run in 2024, but what is interesting is not just who is here, but who is not here. Big figures within the Republican Party, like Mitt Romney, like the former US Vice President, Mike Pence, the former US Ambassador to the United Nations, Nikki Haley, all of them have their own ambitions, and any of them could be influential come 2024.
If a week is a long time in politics, then 4 years is a lifetime. But if Donald Trump wants to run again, right now, there doesn't seem to be much to stop him. Alistair Bunkle, Sky News, Orlando.
It's been revealed one schoolgirl managed to escape after gunmen abducted her classmates in Nigeria. 317 girls are still missing after being snatched in the second school attack in little over a week. Parents and teachers are calling on the government to do more to protect students, as Emma Birchley reports.
When bandits came to her room, Masauda Umar hid silently beneath her bed. But she was the only one to escape the raid on her school in Zamfara State in northern Nigeria. 317 other girls were kidnapped at gunpoint.
One of the bandits drew the hands of the house captain and slapped her and asked her to go. Then the bandits asked everybody to go inside the hostel and they chased some people and asked some to leave. And then they walked towards our own room and knocked on the door. I was coming out from the door and I met somebody, but ran back and hid under my bed.
This is just the latest attack on Nigeria's academies and their students. They're then used in warfare or traded for profit by military groups. It's an all too common problem in a country gripped by civil war. These boys, 47 of them, the latest to be released. For the parents reunited with their children, relief. But the boys' eyes tell a story of 2 weeks of trauma, not knowing if they'd see their families again. Many parents are now too scared to send their children to school, blaming their government for failing to protect them. One father, also a teacher, has lost two children and fears they may not come home.
You have nothing to say than to pray to God. But we are not 100% sure that they can bring back our girls in time. And we are not 100% sure that even if they bring them back, they will not come back with some injuries in their body.
And a return to school terrifies Masauda too.
I'm scared of going back to school because of what happened. It really got me scared. But I will go back if the government tackle insecurity.
Police and military continue to search for Masauda's school friends. She can only hope it's successful. Emma Birchley, Sky News.
Now, the Chancellor will deliver his budget on Wednesday. As well as a cash injection to help the high street, he's expected to reveal a mortgage guarantee scheme for first-time buyers. Well, joining me now is Alfie Stirling, the Director of Research and Chief Economist at the New Economics Foundation. Good morning to you. Much being made of this £5 billion injection. That's really going to be the headliner, isn't it?
I think it may be, although, of course, what happens to the furlough scheme and confirmation that the furlough scheme is extended may well end up being the single most important announcement on the day. But certainly £5 billion for the high street will be really important, especially if it doesn't come with too many conditions or stipulations. That the key question, I think, over the rest of this year will be how much has household spending changed permanently? How much have people shifted towards online shopping and not going to hospitality near their offices? And what impact that might have for the high street longer term.
There's also this line about the accidental savers, that people have saved a lot of money through lockdown. And we've heard various commentators saying that really spending our way out of economic recession is the way to go, and that's what will happen. What are your thoughts on that?
So I think the overall story here is that the recovery, if government doesn't do anything, will be very K-shaped. So with one part of the population really recovering fast and rapidly, that's the people who have been fortunate enough to keep their jobs, to actually build up savings and disposable income, because the sectors of the economy they normally spend in, non-essential retail, hospitality, tourism, they've all been locked down. So they've got a lot of pent-up spending, if you like. But the other part of the population, 20-25% is what the current numbers look like, have seen a real hit to income. And of course, these are the people working in those sectors that have been shut down, and they're at risk now of a really, really rough time unless government puts in place support that has been needed now for 12 months. You know, when thinking about the self-employed falling through the cracks, people on universal credit because they fell through the furlough scheme, not having the support they need. And it's a big divergence now in this K-shaped recovery that is the danger going forward.
And this mortgage guarantee scheme, 95% mortgages for first-time buyers, is that entirely new? Isn't that sort of Help to Buy in a different name?
It is. It's a continuation of the sorts of policies we've seen now for quite a while. I mean, I do find this really quite concerning, actually. I mean, one reason it's concerning is because we seem to have a culture in this country where public debt is somehow incredibly toxic or bad, even when government has very low interest rates and savers are desperate to lend to government. And yet private debt in the form of, you know, getting first-time buyers, people with not often a very large deposit, to borrow more and more to keep the housing market afloat and to keep the economy moving is somehow good and progressive. And it's just not the case. It's a real risk to the economy. But the second reason is that actually these sorts of products, these financial products to increase demand for housing from ever-increasing portions of the population by extending credit, all they do in the long run is increase house prices unless you can actually do something about the supply of housing. And so, very sadly, it won't be first-time buyers and those that are just out of reach of housing that will benefit in the long run. It's those who already have property who will benefit from the increase in house prices. And I think that could be a real problem if we want to address what I described earlier as this K-shaped recovery, with a portion of the population missing out.
And for the billions of pounds that has so far been spent, we are going to have to pay back. What are we looking at in terms of taxes?
So the interesting thing is actually that this pandemic has exposed two really important truths. One is that when you're in a crisis, there isn't really a constraint on government borrowing. And that's because all the savings in the population that get built up by people who are doing OK, they need to go somewhere. They need to go somewhere safe. And in a recession, government is one of the few safe places. At the same time, the central bank can also guarantee government debt. So in a crisis like this, actually government can borrow very cheaply. And in fact, we've had negative interest rates, we've had interest rates well below inflation, effectively government being paid to borrow. That money doesn't need to be paid back. But what does need to happen is that through time, we can't maintain this level of borrowing. And actually the second really important lesson from this pandemic is that our public services were far too brittle and vulnerable going into this crisis. You know, I'm thinking not enough capacity in the NHS, a safety net that was one of the weakest in Europe until we temporarily brought in the furlough scheme. And that does need to be corrected and restored. And to do that, to have, you know, permanently stronger public insurance, we do need higher taxes for the long term. And that's the key there. And I think, therefore, you know, moving towards higher taxes at this budget and making those announcements for the future would be a positive step.
Higher taxes for the long term. Alfie Stirling, thank you very much for sharing your analysis with us. Thank you.
Many thanks.
OK, Isabel's here now with the weather. Is it going to be lovely enough for you to have your run?
I am going to run as soon as I get home, 9:15, because it's lovely. I mean, it will be a bit murky first thing, and it will be for many across central and eastern parts, but then the sun will return. There'll be a lovely Sunday once again.
Look forward to brighter skies. The weather, sponsored by Qatar Airways.
Not quite as sunny from the start, though. There will be more mist and low cloud around that will gradually burn back to the east coast. The cloud across Scotland and Northern Ireland should break nicely too. And as I said, it's an improving picture for many of us. So, yes, it's quite chilly out there where we've had the breaks in the cloud overnight, for example, through the heart of the country. It's about -2 locally, but it will get up to around 10 to 13 degrees today with sunshine. That's just above average. Chilly on exposed coast where it could well turn rather more misty and murky through the course of the afternoon. The southeastern coast, an example, maybe southeast Ireland, but otherwise it's a lovely end to the day. And then you'll find that tonight there are changes. The north turning frosty with some patchy fog, but southern and eastern areas increasingly murky again with mist, low cloud and fog that will push right across southern Britain and up into southern Ireland with that quite brisk east wind. It will burn back to the coast for many, but it could persist through the Midlands tomorrow, parts of Lincolnshire as well. So here, maybe 6-7 degrees at best. Elsewhere, though, again, plenty of blue sky, highs of around 10 to 13 degrees.
The weather, sponsored by Qatar Airways.
Two Holocaust survivors are calling on Boris Johnson to meet them ahead of a Commons vote, which could force the government to take a tougher stance on China's treatment of Uyghur Muslims. The so-called genocide amendment would allow the UK to limit trade with any country committing genocide. So far, the government has opposed it. Let's speak to Dorit Oliver-Wolff, who joins me now. Good morning to you. What exactly are you calling on the UK government to do in terms of the Uyghur situation?
Well, good morning. And I'm calling on the government. First of all, it would be wonderful if Boris Johnson would meet up with me and my colleague Ruth. But it is not against China, I have to point out, because I love the Chinese culture and I love the Chinese people. I love everybody, but I'm completely against genocide. As a Holocaust survivor, I know how it is to be taken away, your freedom, your dignity, and to be waiting for the next person who is going to kill you, gas chambers, etc. And now it's happening again. And I am asking for the government to accept that this is a genocide. It is not anybody's imagination. It is happening now. It was not yesterday. It is happening now. Look at those people. I mean, it is just a crime. And we are joining in accepting a crime that is killing people. Everybody is entitled to be free. I mean, how can we stand by and enjoy television and everything, every daily enjoyment that we are still alive, even though that we have got this coronavirus epidemic, we are still free. But these people have to be freed. There is no question. It is wrong. And the British government I mean, we should be the beacon of democracy and we should stand by it. We should not allow other people to treat humans inhumanly.
And that's as strongly as you feel about this, that the government is standing by while the Uyghur Muslims are being persecuted in China. Is that your belief?
Yes, and of course they should put the amendment through that they accept it, because it is still not accepted. And we cannot accept to have a government that is taking it just, yes, we'll do something. It is now the time to definitely do something about it. And be it Uyghur people or any other oppressed people, it is just wrong. And please, please, if Boris Johnson is watching, if he gets up this early, of course, if he could just grant Ruth and I to talk to him about it, it would be absolutely amazing. And also, please, anybody who is watching, could you join to sign the petition? Believe it or not, we reached 43,000. It's amazing. And it only shows that people do care. So please help us. And the British government should change the amendment, please.
As a Holocaust survivor, what would you say to Boris Johnson? How would you be able to express what it's like to be in those circumstances and the need for international help?
First of all, I would tell Boris Johnson, if he wants to know what the suffering is all about, to read my memoirs From Yellow Star to Pop Star, and I would even sign it for him. But that explains how the Jews were treated during the Holocaust. And I would just talk to him, because I met him once and he's very charming, just before he became prime minister. But I would just ask him to join and to do something about it, because it is commerce and money is, of course, very important. We all have to live. But human life is more important. And what is the price of a Uyghur? What is the price of any of us? What price do you put on each head? It has to be stopped. That's what I would ask him to do.
How confident are you of a meeting or even a conversation with the Prime Minister before the amendment on Tuesday?
Well, if he can listen to it, if it's not stopped by the secretaries and the private the people who are around him, if it's really passed on to him, I'm quite sure he would say, because he's a very compassionate... I had a journey with him from Eastbourne on the train to London, and we had a long talk. And I found him most humorous, very funny. And I think that whilst he's very, very busy, and, you know, he has a lot thrown onto him, coronavirus, Brexit. But this is... I want to appeal to him, to his human feelings as a human being, to another human being, to have compassion and understanding that these are people who haven't done anything wrong. It is just because perhaps they pray to their God in a different way than other people pray. Everybody, every human being should have freedom and right for life and living. And we cannot sit here sipping our cup of cha, you see, I can say that, and think, oh, well, it is happening up. It's nothing to do with us. Everything has to do with us, because if it hurts us, it can be my next door neighbor tomorrow. It is just wrong. And please, please think about it. If you were in the same position, if one of your family would be behind bars and their bodies used to body parts to give away and be killed and be just simply taken away the freedom. It's wrong.
Dorit Oliver-Wolff, thank you very much for speaking with us.
Thank you very much for listening, and I hope you do something about it. Thank you.
Welcome back with us this morning again to take us through the newspapers, the anthropologist Mariana Hotta and the broadcaster Pete Price. Welcome back to you both, your final outing of the morning. Starting with the Sunday Telegraph. And Marianne, you've had a look at this story, and it's the story on all of the front pages, the budget and what we might expect. They're kicking off with a possible tax on online deliveries.
So obviously there's been a massive windfall, basically, for all those online companies who, when you're thinking about the big ones like Amazon, you know, their tax bills are small anyway because they have teams and teams of lawyers and tax specialists work out the most effective way of not paying tax that is, I guess, legal. So the question is, obviously, we're looking at a high street that has been crippled over the past 100 years, and we're possibly facing hundreds of bankruptcies. What the Chancellor is probably going to announce in the budget on Wednesday is additional support for those businesses to get back to a position where they can open and thrive over 2021 and get back on their feet. So businesses should be able to claim up to £18,000 to get ready to trade again. Things like hairdressers, gyms, all the non-essential shops that have been closed for periods of months. And the question is, the way the Telegraph has framed it is that this is kind of going to be stealth taxes. But the bottom line is that there's a £43 billion shortfall in the UK budget because COVID has been very, very expensive. Now, obviously, this is the rainy day for which governments plan, but we also need to be on a strong economic footing to kind of grow and prosper moving forwards. So his suggestions what's going to be proposed probably on Wednesday is that there will be a freeze effectively on the thresholds for income tax. I think that's the one that's going to impact the most people. So for the next 3 years, the threshold where people start paying tax, so that's £12,500, and the threshold for people becoming higher rate taxpayers, so that's currently £50,000, won't go up. And so effectively, that means more people, as wages rise with inflation, more people will fall into those brackets. So an extra 1.5 million people will end up in the higher taxpaying bracket by 2024. So he's not increasing income tax, he's freezing the thresholds, which is kind of a different way of bringing more money into the Treasury coffers.
And allows the Conservatives to say that they're sticking to their pledge of not raising taxes. Pete, let's have a look at the Sunday Mirror. And we've seen, haven't we, that the Royals coming out and giving their advice on everybody taking up the vaccine. We've seen the Queen, unprecedented message from the Queen. And now Kate and William taking on the anti-vaxxers.
I think it's essential. Elton John and Michael Caine have done a video. Everybody's getting involved with it. I read in one of the Sunday papers today that 200,000 NHS and care workers haven't had the jab yet. Now, I think if I'm right in saying if we didn't have vaccination, we'd still have polio, which was eradicated in this world. I think it's absolutely stupid. I can't understand their mentality. I think if you work in a care home and you don't have the jab, I think that's very unfair to all the patients and people out there. I find it bizarre, but also the internet has got an awful lot to answer for, because without the internet, we wouldn't have had these problems. There's these anti-vaxxers, and they really need help because they've got problems. Having said that, there are many out there that are just doing it for a laugh. I mean, do we want to get out of lockdown? Everybody watching now, do we want to get out of lockdown? Do we want another lockdown in June? Because we've got to have the vaccination. Sorry, I'm getting upset. It really, really annoys me.
Do you think that people should only be employed in the future if they're able to show proof of having been vaccinated? Would you go that far?
I would. I would absolutely, especially within the NHS and within the care service. Absolutely. There are loved ones in those homes. They need protecting. Absolutely.
To the Sun, Marianne.
I'll tell you what. If they wanted to go on holiday, they'd get a vaccination in a shot if that got them away.
Interesting. To the Sun, let's look at this story that some suggesting that teachers are hatching a plan to disrupt the return of students on the March the 8th.
Oh, that wasn't going to be a story that I was going to talk about. But I think teachers are under massive pressure. They're facing, you know, uncertainty in terms of what the situation is going to be when they're back in front of a group of students in busy secondary schools particularly. They have to not only try and help their students get back up to speed, they're also, some of the other stories in the papers are saying that, you know, once kids go back to school, those education professionals are going to see the real impact, psychological, mental health impacts that have disproportionately affected kids coming from poorer backgrounds as well. And the question is, you know, do teachers feel safe standing at the front of their classrooms? And I think I would certainly advocate that teachers, early years professionals, should be in one of the priority groups for vaccination, because as soon as you've got a teacher who's ill, or you've got a lot of teaching staff who become ill or get positive COVID tests, then that knock-on impact on the rest of the school ecosystem and all the families who are affected by children who then perhaps can't go to school because they don't have teachers, or perhaps might have had close contact with teachers because they were helping them with work or what have you, and they're having to stay at home, then immediately we're all sort of back to square one. Parents are having to stay at home or perhaps curtail their work. And students just need to be able to get on with learning, to have those social opportunities to grow as people, because otherwise the impacts of COVID are going to be felt for more than a generation, because we're going to have damaged young people who just can't access the support they need, and teachers who are on the front line. So we really need to rally round, support teachers, listen to their concerns. And that is part of what Pete was saying, that, you know, we're all having to pull together to get life back to normal and support the people who need extra support as much as possible.
Brilliant, especially on a story that you weren't thinking that you were going to do. Quite clearly, have opinions on it. Pete, are you going to talk about? Are you going to talk about litter? What's this story about?
Oh yeah, I can talk about litter as well.
I think that one's Pete.
The litter story is incredible. They're talking about finding people for throwing litter out of cars. This is a pet hate of mine. I'm from the old school. When you put your litter in your pocket, you took it home with you. I have actually, and I'm not a fighter, but I love an argument, but I've
You're
actually
not a
chased
fighter,
a car.
Pete.
No, not a fighter as
a
in
verbal
physical,
fighter. A verbal
but I
fighter.
I am a fighter as in I've chased cars down motorways that have thrown litter out. I am incensed, but I don't know how they're going to police it. They're going to do it with CCT camera, but I just think it's the most disgraceful thing. And the way I would punish them, by the way, I'd go to their house and empty bins of litter all over their lounge, all over their furniture, the lot.
Yeah, not obsessed at all. But I do share your concerns. I mean, with the lockdown, sort of doing, you know, much more walking and running outdoors, the litter strewn everywhere. When you're outside of a car, you really do notice it, don't you, Miriam?
Oh, it's absolutely disgusting. I couldn't believe it when I read this story. It costs £1 billion every year to clear up the litter that people chuck out of cars, chuck out of their pockets onto our street, fly tip. That's 30 million tons of rubbish. And some people say, oh, we need better education campaigns. But I agree with Pete. It's common sense.
No.
Don't throw crap out of your windows.
Absolutely.
Put it in a bin.
Well said. Now, this is a really lovely little story in the Sunday Times. Who can tell us what Petflix is? Marianne, I think you've had a look at this. Yes.
This is kind of sweet but hilarious and also slightly worrying. There's a video on demand service which you can pay a kind of monthly charge for, that should in principle help relax your dog. And so you can pay a subscription for them, like you're paying perhaps for Netflix. You can pay for Petflix, and you get videos of basically like dog's eye view of running through fields, watching birds.
So they can't actually do the running through fields, but they can look at it on the screen. Virtual dog walking. What do you think of that idea, Pete?
I love it. Absolutely love it. It's, I mean, the animals now, you go out for a walk and everybody's got their dog and they've all bought the dogs. And by the way, a dog's for life, not for Christmas.
Absolutely.
So just keep them
Marianne up. And Pete,
keep
thank you so much for taking us
great.
Through the papers. Good to see you. Take care. Have a great week.